Good morning. It's good to see everybody out this morning. Beautiful day out too, by the way. Beautiful day. If you're visiting with us this morning, one thing that we ask is that you fill out a connect card on the seat in front of you. And as you're leaving, stop at the welcome desk and drop it off, and they'll have a little present for you. So it's a fair exchange, a little time to fill in a card, and you get a present. So, hey, good deal. If you haven't picked up your communion packet, now would be a good time to do that. They're back in the corner of the auditorium there. So go grab that if you haven't. Thank you cards and announcements. I don't have a bulletin. Okay, upcoming events. Grief Share starts again on February 25th. That's a Thursday. It'll be at 6:30. So if you know anybody you think might benefit from the Grief Share meetings, it's a good deal, something you'd at least want to see myself or Ernie about, and we could go in more detail with you. But if you think you know anybody that needs that, or if you need it yourself or be interested. Postponed Tuesday morning Lady Bible study. In-person worship or online details at the Millwood Church of Christ if you want to take advantage of that. And the reading plans are still available out in the foyer if you want to dive into that. It's not too late. Time to catch up on that if you want to commit to reading through the Bible in 2021. Prayer concerns, it's a short list. Praise the Lord. So you want to look at those folks there. And add to Sarah Mazurchik. Her father passed away. If you want to keep, I guess it's Mazurchik. Am I saying that right? What is it? Mazurchik family in your prayers. Update on Ron and Donna Bailey. Doing much better. And they want to thank everyone for the cards and prayers. Please pray for the Vanskoy family. Jay has been very sick with heart problems and is now in the hospital with COVID. Danny and Carmen are both at home with COVID, so the Vanskoy family as well. Please be in prayer for George Fall, 3 years with bone cancer. He has a painful lump on his neck, and he is getting weaker, and he has limited kidney function. That's George Fall says, but he keeps teaching his classes. So praise the Lord for that. Says your this is in your bulletin as well. Your virtual journey starts here. That's a starting point lesson, so you want to take note of that. It's in your bulletin as well. We did the prayer concerns. If you'd please stand, I'll be reading from Revelation 22:7, and this is Jesus speaking. It's very short, but to the point, and if there's anybody who struggles and says, I can't understand the Bible, this is very easy to understand. Jesus says, behold, I am coming soon. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy in this book. And we weren't created by a God who loves us, just turned loose on the earth with no guidance. It's all right here from Genesis to Revelation. And if you dive in, you apply it to your life, do what God asks us to do, we spend eternity in heaven with him, and it's that simple. So let's remember that. Let's go to him in prayer, please. Dear Lord God, we bow before you this day, dear Lord, just praising you, uplifting your name, thanking you. You're so good to us, dear Lord. And we just pray that as a congregation, we are doing things that are pleasing to you, dear Lord, that we share the gospel the way we're supposed to. We live our lives the way we're supposed to, dear Lord, and knowing that we make you happy fills us. Dear Lord, we pray that you be with us this worship time, and may everybody's ears be open, hearts be receptive. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
So Our communion meditation this morning is going to be a hard one for me to deliver, but I will persevere. The words to the last song, death could not hold Jesus, nor will it hold any of us unless we allow it to. May we allow the Word of God, God's Word, Jesus' voice, to guide our hearts as we prepare for the Lord's Supper this morning. In the first letter to the Corinthian church, the Apostle Paul realized and knew that there were some corrections and then some admonishments that needed to be done, directed by him to the Corinthian church of which he established. And Paul identifies his authority to do so by his words in chapter 11, starting with verse 23, at the institution of the Lord's Supper. For the Corinthian church was making what is the most important event of our worship this morning a mockery, one that was wrong in many ways. And to prepare his letter, he wrote these words within this particular letter. He said, "For what I received from the Lord, that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread and the cup and communed with his disciples, thus setting an example for them to follow, the Corinthian church to follow, just as Jesus set the example for his disciples to follow." And within the first letter to the Corinthians, starting in chapter 10, the corrections and the admonishments started. For within the church, there were many, using the words of Dave from Sunday school, internal battles within that congregation. Praise God that we don't have many ourselves, and that we use the word of God to correct and to encourage each other to hold true to the faith that we confess, not only before one another, but before God himself. The Apostle Paul wrote of two distinct cups. The first cup, in chapter 10, starting with verse 15, he writes, in verse 16, he writes, "Is not the cup of blessing, of thanksgiving, for which we bless, of which we give thanks, a participation or the sharing in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a sharing or a participation in the body of Christ? Since there is one bread, or since there is one loaf, we who are many or one body, for we all partake of that one loaf, our Lord Jesus." So the cup that Paul first talks about is the cup of the Lord, the cup of grace, a cup of forgiveness, a cup of mercy, the cup of life giving blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, of which we partake now. But since this is a letter of admonishment and correction, he writes just before that in chapter 10 of another cup, of cup of which they are not to partake of. It was a cup of the evil one. It was the cup of idolaters. It was the cup of immorality, a cup of testing the Lord himself, a cup of grumbling, a cup of temptation, the cup that is offered by the world today. In verse 21 in chapter 10 of 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul writes, "You cannot drink the cup of the Lord in the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord in the table of demons." And that is why we come together, to partake of the cup of the Lord. That is what bonds us together, and to partake of the bread of life, our Lord Jesus, the emblems of which we share, the emblems of which we partake, and participate in. That is why we're here, and that is the example set by the Apostle Paul and all those after him that we must follow in order to have unity within Christ's church, to have that unity. He also writes in chapter 12, verses 12 and 13, "For even as the body is one and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are still one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of the one Spirit. For it is through the strength of the Holy Spirit that is lives within us and that we receive as a gift at our baptism is when we're unified as one. And it is only within ourselves that we can separate ourselves from God. And thus we have instituted before us the Lord's Supper, which bonds us together, because we all partake of the one cup and the one loaf. So as you partake, it is not alone that you do so. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That is the hope that we have and that we share also. And it is the Lord's Supper that underlines all that, no matter what this world gives to us to deal with. May we pray as one, please. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we are thankful for what you have instituted. We are thankful for the example set first by your Son, our Lord Jesus, and then all those who followed him in faith. We are thankful for what we here at Millwood can share with each other and proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. So as we partake, Father, of the fruit of the grape, which represents his blood, and the bread we break that represents his body, we ask, Father, that you bless not only what we partake, but also bless each and every one who participates. Lord, we love you so much. We ask this all in the name of our Lord, our Master, our King, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
by my side, the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need, his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend. It has been paid, for Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and never is my plea. Are released, I can sing, I am free, and not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day, I know he will renew. Till I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall
ever heard someone sing a song and then you wonder why you don't hear that song on the radio more often? I never heard that before. What a beautiful song. So some of you guys came to me after last Sunday when my tablet died, and you said that needs to happen more often. No. I'm thankful that God listened to me over you, because guess what decided to work this morning? So yesterday, I'm driving around with Gabe Hamilton, one of my best friends, and I'm sitting at the four-way stop in Danville, right next to the BP gas station up on the hill. And I just came back from the Blonde Robin, got some coffee, which is always great. They paid me $15 to say that this morning, so I'll collect that afterwards. So I get that. I go down to Danville, outdoor. Sure enough, they didn't have ammo. Go figure. So I'm sitting there at the four-way stop, and the truck ahead of me pulls up, and I go to take off. And I don't move. And not only do I don't move, I hear and I feel this very low grunt coming from my car. and the whole thing begins to shake. And for those of you that don't know, there's one important detail that I left out. I drive a 5-speed manual. And anyone in the history of vehicles who's ever driven a manual know exactly what that means. You're in the wrong gear. So here I am in third gear, milking that clutch. I was like, what in the world is going on? I could feel, and I'm stupid. And put in first gear, and we all know what it feels like when you make a mistake while you're driving, and you can feel people staring at you, and you feel judged. You don't want to look around, but you just know somebody noticed that, and you just kind of look straight ahead and pretend that didn't happen, hope no one's around. Well, sure enough, I end up looking around, make sure I didn't know anyone who just saw that accident. And there's an Amish guy by the bank laughing at me. Now, no offense, but if an Amish guy is laughing at your driving, there's probably a mistake. There's probably something big going on. You want to feel dumb, have an Amish guy who doesn't even drive judge your driving. I mean, the guy acts like he never tried to take off with his horse in third gear before. Quick story. We'll get back to that, but store that away. There's something important in that story that we'll pull out later. I want you to turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 8. And in that, we're going to find a story where someone is faced with some life-changing events. There's going to be this Philippian eunuch. And we're going to see how something's going to happen that will change his whole viewpoint on his religion, his life, and the future in just a short encounter with the Son of God, intimately called Jesus Christ. So if you turn or scroll to Acts chapter 8, we'll start in verse 25, and we'll read to verse 35. So when they had solemnly testified and spoken the word of the Lord, they started back to Jerusalem and were preaching the gospel to many villages and the Samaritans. But an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, "Get up, go south to the road that descends from Jerusalem to Gaza." This road is a desert road. So he got up, and he went, and there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure, and he had come to Jerusalem to worship. And he was returning and sitting in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go up and join this chariot." Philip ran up and heard him read in Isaiah the prophet and said, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And he said, "Well, how could I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the passage of scripture which he was reading was this: "He was led to a sheep to the slaughter. He was as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In humiliation his judgment was taken away. Who will relate his generation? For his life is removed from the earth." The eunuch answered Philip and said, "Please tell me, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or someone else?" Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning from this scripture, he preached Jesus Christ to him. And many of you may know that that is Isaiah chapter 53, which actually the Jews to this day, many of them have said that Isaiah is no longer an inspired prophet because so many Jews were reading this passage and converting to Christianity. So this eunuch is a convert to Judaism, which is a very short phrase, but biblically he's what we call a proselyte. He's a convert from a different religion into Judaism. And he's coming to the capital of the Jewish world, Jerusalem, to give an offering to God on his way back. And he's reading the 53rd chapter of the prophet Isaiah, which tells of this man, this mediator, this Messiah who would come into the world, save mankind by providing a way for them to be reunited again with God. And isn't it funny that right after offering giving an offering of worship to God, that this eunuch is reading an Old Testament prophecy and is wondering if there's more to worship than he's familiar with. He is curious whether or not that this passage is speaking about Isaiah the prophet, or if it's talking about someone or something greater than the prophet. Because if it's talking about Isaiah, depending on the offering he gave for worship, would mean that in the eyes of God that he was clean and obedient. However, the implication is that if it wasn't speaking of Isaiah, that the offering that he gave didn't account for anything, and that he's no longer clean, but he's dirty. He's no longer redeemed, but instead he will be ridiculed. He will be guilty in the eyes of God. So there's a lot going on here. And those are two different extremes, and one is commendable where the other is condemnable. One is sin removing, the other is sin abiding. And if this prophet is speaking of anyone other than himself, this eunuch would be committed to the protege, the old software, the sign that pointed toward the exit, but missing the exit. He's putting his hope and his everlasting life in something that is inferior, substandard. Because if this prophet is, if this prophecy is speaking about anyone other than Isaiah himself, the eunuch is putting his trust into the hands of the law, which we know cannot save him. So when he asked the question in verse 34, there's more writing on the answer than just a let-up of his curiosity. His whole future, the course of all of his actions, pivot and lean on the answer that Philip would give him. And the answer is obvious when Philip says, from there he began preaching Jesus to him. So the implied answer is that no, this prophecy is not speaking of Isaiah, and it is speaking of someone who is greater, specifically Jesus Christ. Could you imagine the type of stress that would come along with the realization that the instrument that you entrusted your everlasting future with is null and void? This is exactly the type of place the eunuch has now unexpectedly found himself in. How awful is it when we are told news that our future has changed? It's no longer the way we expected things to play out. This mirage of perfect, peaceful paradise has faded. The comfort of the consistency of our circumstances has become a ghost, a figment of our imagination. Something that seemed so tempting, but now is so far away from being reality in our life. Have you ever had news so bad that it made you feel hollow? It was like the words bounced around inside of a centerless shell. They wouldn't necessarily leave, but there wasn't anything for them to be planted in your mind. So you were just left with the cyclical thought of bad news. That's how I imagine that it would be when you come face to face with the understanding or the realization that you have rested your salvation on something that isn't substantial enough. Now, on a happy note, though, do you remember the story I told you at the very beginning with the car and me being stupid and the Amish guy laughing at me? Well, I couldn't move because I was in the wrong gear. And the way I found out that I was in the wrong gear is the context clues. The low grunt, the feeling of the vibration, the not moving. And sometimes we can be in the wrong gear in our life, and we can be at a standstill. And the same way that I found out I was in the wrong gear in my car is the same way that we have to find out if we're in the wrong gear in life. We have to look at the context clues. I want to ask you a simple question, though. What would you do if you realized this morning that you were in a standstill because you, like myself, were in the wrong gear? There are so many roadblocks and distractions in this life that we can really lose focus on what is important in life. Life plays its game like a magician on us, and while he has us zeroed in on his left hand, he is really pulling a trick on us with his right. And have you ever noticed that even in some of the hardest times of our life, when we feel the most human and conscious about ourselves, that with time, when life eases up just a little, we can tend to fall back into the foot snares of distraction and disarrangement that this world offers? Unfortunately and fortunately for us, most of the distractions in our life are self-induced. Now, the reason I say unfortunately is because that means that the blame is on us. It is our fault. It's in our hands. The blood is shed on us. But the reason I say fortunately is because since the fault was in our hands, that means the opportunity to fix it also lies within our hands. And we can, if we recognize them, remove those roadblocks from our life that keep us from entering into salvation or abiding in salvation, having faith in Christ. Possibly one of the most outwardly evident things that distract us from making the choice to follow God is simply just life. There's always a baseball game, there's football games, volleyball games. Instead of communion with God, we are commuting to work that requires high hours and offers low pay. There's family functions, vacations with friends, vacations from our family. There's always something to prepare for. There's always something to plan, something that always needs fixed, like the washer, the car. And maybe for you, it's sinful things that you don't want to give up. Maybe it's the drugs. Maybe there's alcohol. Maybe it's pornography. Maybe it's surrounding yourself with those who you know pull you away from Christ. But there's always something in our life who seems to get away of our relationship with Jesus Christ. To make all the normal distractions even more pressing, now we have things such as sickness and the physical well-being for our loved ones to account for. And now we find ourselves in this weird situation where we have to balance the physical health of our Christian friends with the spiritual health of our Christian friends. Do we not go to church and hope that they don't fall by the wayside? Or do we all go to church and hope they don't get sick and die? There is a paradox that we find ourselves in everyday situations. And we have to work through those and move through those and figure out what Christ wants us to do. Otherwise, they will remain just that, roadblocks. They will stop us in our tracks. Some of these things are inevitable, but oftentimes, if we're honest with ourselves, the things that we call inevitable are actually preventable. We rationalize the things that are subsidiary, and we make them substantial in our mind. Meanwhile, forgetting the Lord's church and his calling to gather together. And if you don't think you need fellowship with other Christians, well, then I will go ahead and sit down. I'll sit right next to Dave, and I will let you come up here and teach. Because if you don't think that we need that fellowship with other Christians, well, then you know something I don't. Because I believe I speak for the overwhelming, the vast majority of us here when we say we are stronger together. There's actually an African proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Now, how true is that? Have you ever said, go ahead, raise your hand, because I think I know what to expect. Have you ever said, if you want it done right, do it yourself? I know I have. And why do we do that? Because we want to get it done, especially in America, right? We are a very tangible people who want to see results. We don't want a project to take a year. We want it to take a month. We don't want to grow up over a course of 18 years. We want to grow up overnight. We're always looking for instant gratification. I'm not going to say that word right now, apparently. We're always looking for some goodness to come out right here and right now. But some things are better with time. Some things age a little better with time, like cheese. Our life situations are like cheese. We're a little moldy, a little nasty. Some of us are a little stinky. But with time, we get better. But we need to really be with one another. We need to have that sort of relationship where we can bear one another's burden, confess each other's sins. And I believe that there is no circumstance or sin that is worth forsaking a relationship with God the Almighty. And if we pursue what we want, then we will, actually, this is a great quote. Pay attention to this. If you don't listen to anything else, pay attention to this. We pursue what we want, then we make sure that there are no biblical commands that we are violating. In essence, we want to know what God will tolerate rather than what he deserves. Maybe we are afraid to ask him what will bring him the most pleasure. Because ignorance feels better than disobedience. Famous preacher once said, isn't that true though? We're always wanting to be right on the outside of the circle. How far can I go before I fall off? But the issue with that is that whole philosophy is built on the idea of what will God tolerate? How far from God can I be until it really matters? How little love do I really need to show God until I'm just not loving? And that's why I'm against a whole list of sins, in my opinion, that some Christians today will tolerate in their lives. So, well, it's not really bad. I can do some of it. I have to be careful. If we're always seeking to do what brings pleasure to God, which is what loving him in part is, right? If we're always seeking to be as close to God as possible and we're always seeking to give him pleasure, there's a lot of sins, a lot of things in our life that we probably wouldn't do as much. Maybe what we watch, maybe the music we listen to, maybe the things that we drink, the games that we play. There's a lot of things in our life that we may be a little more conservative about if we were doing them with the intent to be as close to God as possible. Just my opinion. In the midst of all these distractions and potential idols, our own mind often even fights against us. Our mind tricks us into thinking that we are worthy, or that we're not worthy to follow God, and that we aren't lovable, or maybe worse of all, that we don't even need God. Now, I have YouTube Red, and for those of you who don't know, I drive to Indiana and back every week. I leave Tuesday afternoon, I come back Friday morning. And so oftentimes my radio, I use YouTube Red, and it plays me different songs and makes playlists, and I like to listen to them because sometimes you get a song that's amazing, and sometimes you get a song that you can't believe someone sung it. And it sounds like a suffocating donkey. But one song came on, and although I didn't like the way it began really, the chorus was really interesting. it said, I'm dumb, I'm young. And this guy goes on, he says all these bad things about himself. He says, I got the type of crazy you can't put back on the shelf. I'm not lovable enough to really put myself out there. And how often do maybe we don't stand in front of the mirror and say, Zach, you are a dumb individual. Zach, you are a numb individual. Zach, you are a crazy. No. Well, maybe. It's weird. Don't do that. But how often do we subconsciously tell ourselves those things? I'm not lovable. We do something that we hurt someone that really means a lot to us, and we say, well, man, maybe this whole love thing isn't for me. Maybe I'm just too dumb to get on in life. Maybe I'm not worth someone investing in. Have you ever told yourself that or maybe thought those things about yourself? Odds are, if you're being honest, the answer is probably yes. And the issue with the lies that go on in our mind is that there's no one who can refute them. The end of that course says, the cruelest lies are the lies that we tell ourselves. No one can refute what's going on in your head. There's a few reasons. Maybe it's no one knows the thoughts that are going in your head. Maybe it's for the better. But maybe they know on a surface level what you're going through. But when they're trying to talk to you, they can never really get below the surface, because there's a root of the issue, a heart in there that hasn't been as completely open and clear and easy to understand as maybe it should have been. So although they say words that seem helpful and words that seem encouraging and words that maybe should fix the situation, we don't allow them to fix the situation because we're not as open to them as we could be. And they can't really get into the heart of the issue and fix it. And so hard fighting against the mind. I learned a lesson this week. Jerry Paul, one of my professors, he's done revivals here before, but a great guy. And I was struggling with something because there was one part of me that knew, and then there was another part of me that felt. And I didn't know how to balance that. I didn't know how to deal with that. And he made a good statement. You can't always logically fix emotions that, well, you can't always logically fix problems that are emotionally stimulated. There's a lot of truth in that. Because if you feel like you know something, you can logically know what to do. You can logically know what to say. Right? We know the biblical response. We know the scriptural response. But it still feels painful. Although we know the outcome, we know, you know, those promises like God works all things together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. That we know that our faith, though it may be put through fire, is being refined as silver or gold. We know those things. We know those promises. But they don't carry much weight with us in those moments, because emotionally we struggle with that. And what's the cause of that? Well, that's because the world has hurt our hearts so much. See, the world has trained us to be really not very good. We're trained to be narcissistic. We're trained not to show empathy. We're trained just to put on a good face. You know, for the girls, put on your makeup and don't share what's really going on. We're told all these things that they sound good on paper, but they really end up hurting us in the long run because they never let us deal with what is really going on. Turn your Bible to Ephesians chapter 2, if you would. And if you're one of those people who struggle, you know the logical response, but you don't know how to deal with that emotionally, all I can say is, if you trust me, listen to this. No matter what, God does love you. Even if you logically know it, but you don't feel it, trust me when I tell you, he does love you. And he does care for you. He is with you. And when it's really hard to remember, put that in the front of your brain and filter everything through that. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 through 8. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air of the spirit that is now working the sons of disobedience. Among them we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging in the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, has made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it's not of yourself, it is a gift of God. The love of God is not something that you earn. The love of God is something that you accept. There's nothing that you can ever do for your to become saved in the sense. Obviously, we can be baptized. We have to repent. We have to go through those things. But there's not enough works I can't do. I can never cross as many old ladies across the street in order to earn my salvation. I can't give enough to charity. I can't help enough people who are hurting to ever become saved. That is not what made God love me. What made God love me is the fact that his son died for me. And when I accept him, when he looks down, he no longer sees me. He sees Jesus Christ. The final and possibly most undermining thing that both Christians and non-Christians do that prevent them from becoming stronger Christians or becoming Christians at all is they hold on to the past. I'm speaking about more than changing music type or other things that have to do with their personal preference. And I would say it's been said before that the most dangerous phrase in the English language is, well, we've always done it that way. But I'm not talking about traditions and our own thoughts and opinions. I'm talking about the things that we've done in the past. Our sin, our trials, our tribulations, those things often hold us back from becoming what we want to be or becoming a Christian to begin with. I'm talking about an eroding idea that we can't be forgiven of the things that we've done in our past. We think about the people we've wronged, the reputation that we've built on lies, the hearts that we've crushed for our own gain. We think about our life motivation after pursuing fleshly pleasure instead of personal holiness. And it prevents us from becoming Christians. Life does it, our mind does it, and our past does it. There are so many things in this world that hold us back from becoming who Christ wants us to become. But Philippians chapter 3, verse 13 says, "Brothers and sisters, I do not regard myself as having take hold of it yet. But one thing I do is I forget what lies behind and I reach forward to what lies ahead." If you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're going to read the verse 9 through 11. Now, oftentimes when people preach on this, they normally use it as a list of people who won't get into heaven. But I would just like to say anybody outside of Christ will not make it to heaven, whether they do these particular sins or they do sins that are in the same family, I guess you want to say it that. But 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 through 11. "Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor idolaters, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." That's a pressing statement because everybody in here has fallen into one of those categories in their life. But notice the words, the first few words in verse 11. "And such were some of you." Here's where it gets positive. "But you were washed. But you were sanctified. But you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of God." See, what makes us loved by God isn't what we've done. It is who is clothed around us. And that is Jesus Christ. "And you were washed. You were justified. And you were sanctified by faith in Christ." Now, isn't that a little relieving? When we think about all the bad things that we've done, knowing that even though we've done those things, Jesus Christ has washed us. That even though we hurt those people, Jesus Christ has justified us. That even though we gave up on God so many times in our past, that Jesus Christ has sanctified us and made us one of His. Now I'm going to ask you that question that I talked about at the beginning of the sermon. The eunuch asked himself a question in Acts chapter 8, verse 36. He said, "What prevents me from being baptized?" You ever thought about what prevents you? Is it your life? Is it your mind? Is it what has happened to you in the past or what you've done in the past? The eunuch, when he asked that question, realized that there was nothing worth holding him back from a relationship with Christ. And the first thing he did is he was baptized. And we're going to offer that same type of invitation this morning. If you realize that you've been holding back, there's something that has anchored you, I'm going to help you. Because I want to see you in heaven. And I don't want there to be anything to hold you back from a faith and a relationship with Jesus Christ. I want you to be able to let go of it all. Because Jesus Christ has forgiven you of it all. And there is no stain that you have ever put on yourself that the blood of Jesus Christ can't wash away. So stand with us as we offer an invitation. Hey guys, I'm so thankful that you were here with us this morning. I love you, God loves you, and I hope that you love everybody in here, and I can't wait to see you till next time. Bow with us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise you and exalt you this day. And Father, we're grateful that we have been able to be here assembled as your people in your house. And Father, I just ask you to bless you, Ted, that is here. Father, watch over us this upcoming week. Father, give us boldness. Father, help us to be that ambassador, that light that you have called us to be. And Father, just now we just thank you for this message. Thank you for Zach and his preparation. Just ask you to bless him and his ministry. Father, continue to watch over each and every one of us through these trials and tribulations that each of us has. And Father, watch over our leaders here at this church. Give them strength to guide us and shepherd us. And Father, ultimately, we just thank you for Jesus and the hope that does lie in him. Father, the great gift that has been bestowed on each and every one of us as we've committed our lives to him, that we have eternal life with you in heaven one day if we are obedient and faithful to the end. So guide us this day, guide us this week. Father, forgive us, Father, when we do fail you. Father, through repentance, we can be restored. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And I feel it stirring in me. This I know for sure. That your love is like a flood. And your mercy never ending. I give my song to you. There's a joy in my soul. Like a morning, this I know for sure, that your grace is enough, and your promise never breaking, I give my song to you. All of your
to you a symphony, singing out loud.